I guess we'll start, right?
Yeah. Okay. Hey guys, my name is Pawan, and that's Janmejay. Both of us work as developers in a company called ThoughtWorks. We work on the Studios division, which is basically the product division of ThoughtWorks. So this talk, we call it Performance Unit 101. Like we called it that, but then what this talk has like evolved into over a period of time is that so this is how you what are all the things that you need to keep in mind? What are all the things you need to keep in mind if you want to scale up your app rather than scale out? And what are the things to keep in mind if you want to build high throughput apps? Is basically what this talk is all about. So this is the gist of all the things that will be covered in this slide deck. This is more for people who look at it online, like we have shared it on SlideShare, but we don't need to go through it right now. So the context of what we are doing, the app in reference, so where most of the things that we have done, is this presentation is basically a result of the last 2.5 years worth of work that JJ and I have done on this app. This app is called Go. Go is basically a release management tool. It runs your builds, it runs your deployments. You can think of it as like Jenkins and your ARI tools, like all of them are being orchestrated by one single tool. So which makes Go a massively distributed run, like scheduling and process running system. Which makes it like complicated. So the predominantly Go is built with Java as the backend, and we use Rails for the front end, for the web app and the UI part of things. It's a managed environment, which means that it runs on a JVM, which means that we don't have any control over how JVM does its memory management and things like that, and how thread context, we don't have any control over any of that. It's managed for us, which makes it all the more tedious. Contrary to what people think that it's a good idea to use a managed environment, we actually faced a lot of problems because of that. And like JJ already said, most of whatever we have done and our toolings have worked only mainly on Linux. You can probably find equivalent of that in other OSs. And what we over a period of time, what we have learned when we do this presentation is from feedback we have got is the approach and learning of what we have. What we are going to talk about is independent of tech stack. It doesn't need to be even though we have Java as our reference app, it doesn't need to be Java specific. What we are going to talk about is independent of tech stack.
So with this we come to what it is all about. So trying to find performance problems, doing it proactively is normally not a good idea. Like one fine day you decide that you want to hunt for performance issues in your app and fix them. You have a good chance that you'll get some, but the amount of effort you'll waste on that and the amount of output, which is the performance issue you likely get out of it, the ratio is going to be very odd. So
how many of you have worked on a software which has had performance issues when it was deployed to production? Okay. So, which means that most managers are like, oh, last release had a performance issue, this release should not have any performance issue, I'll assign you devs. Okay,
yeah.
Devs, now go and look for, that's an anti-pattern according to us.
It Rathapur emphasizes that don't be out there with the gun looking for trouble. Let the trouble come to you, it'll come to you. And have the right set of tools when it comes to you to figure out exactly what the trouble is and figure out exactly how to fix it with like minimal effort and end up getting the fix right the first time. So that's the key of performance tuning, more or less. So how do you know that your app is slow? Your dashboard is slow, probably you have like a page which everyone comes to, like home page of the app, that is slow, or your JavaScript is slow, that's like a performance issue. Builds are taking too long. In context of Go is a build server, right? So it runs builds. The builds are taking too long after your VCS check-in, that's slow. If the workers which are running on different other machines and are talking to the server, they're taking too long to get work when they start executing the build. So that is one kind of slowness. We check into SCM, but Go doesn't find out about it in like a 1 minute, 2 minute time limit. That's a problem. The process is hogging too much resources. You've given it a 16-core, 8 gig box that is required for a basic setup with like one build and one agent. That's not good, right? So
basically what that means is in the context of your app, right, most people think of UI not responding as slow, but UI not responding is like a very like one thing of the app. On a simple website, that might be the only like only thing that matters. But on a real web application, let's say it has like background processes, asynchronous things happening, there measuring the throughput and what is slow itself will become a very hard thing to define. So even if your UI may be snappy, the application throughput itself may be very slow. So
it might not be sending enough mails, it might not be sending enough messages, it might not be modifying enough files that we're supposed to modify in the background. It can be anything.
It can be, right? So just because your end users are not saying, oh, my UI is slow, doesn't mean that your app is actually slow or if it has a performance issue. That's what it really means. Like even in our case, that's what it meant. Like all the background things that are supposed to happen, if it, any of that is slow, it means the app has a performance issue.
It still is slow in spite of users seeing it as really fast.
So, in terms of acceptance, right, like most features or most requirements that you work on need to have some endpoint. So, typically in your performance fixing work, let's say somebody has come back to you and said, okay, dude, we have a performance issue on our production app, what do we do, right? So, first thing you need to do is define how slow is slow, right? Because some people may just be very aggressive, like they may not have the patience, like they may have like a really huge and complicated setup. Like typically this is the case with products, like if your product is being in different kind of environments, if it's not hosted and you know if you are selling it to different kinds of people and setups, and if they have some huge or weird case and they don't realize that but they're just being unreasonable, for that, just to tackle that case, the first thing you actually need to define is how slow is slow. For different kinds of setups, what is an acceptable response time or acceptable throughput is something that you need to first define, right? Okay, let's say we define that. How fast is fast? You don't want to spend the next 1 year fixing a problem, right? You need to figure out, typically performance fixes, for geeks, it's actually a big time dev adrenaline. So they typically say, oh my god, like this is a very like really nice problem, let me just put all my effort in fixing this. But then they may get carried away and they may like work on it forever, right? So for you to figure out when to end it, you need to also have an upper limit of how fast is fast. So you need to know a lower limit of how slow is slow, you need to have an upper limit of how fast is fast. That kind of figures out what is the boundary of your work.
And these things have like different definitions, right? It might be that I as a manager want my app to have a throughput of 5 requests per second. That's a different definition compared to I as a user want my page to respond within like 20 milliseconds or half a second, right? These two requirements may be mutually conflicting, they may be mutually independent, or they may be somehow related to each other. So like identifying what is your benchmark is kind of important.
Yeah. So, benchmark using realistic setup, like it works on my DevBox doesn't really, I think we all know this, it doesn't matter if it works on your DevBox, right? It needs to be on a realistic setup, and it needs to be like, if it's a product, you better make sure like you have like profiles of different usage patterns and things like that. So, make sure that it's realistic. I don't even need to get into that. One thing, like going back to the thing that we said, don't go on a goose hunt of where is the problem. The reason we say that is because it's hard. Like it's like finding a needle in a haystack, right? Instead of that, what you would rather do is reduce the time to fix issues. Like issues will keep coming up, right? Like bugs will keep coming up. So what you need to do, according to us, is have a repeatable and automated way to set up an environment where you can easily get to the problem that a customer is facing, right? So that is what is more important than I would rather spend my effort, if somebody feels that, okay, we need to fix performance issues, I would rather spend my effort in trying to automate things but not actually fix anything. Because what you would rather do is wait until you hit the problem, immediately reproduce it, fix it, and then get on. So that is where, like in our experience over the past 2.5 years, that's what we have found to be most valuable, where we have automated scripts to like within 45 minutes, we can get to any customer setup with just one execution of, one line execution of a command. Like that's the kind of automation we have.
And the important thing is repeatable is essentially even more important, because once you find a problem and once you fix a problem, you want to run it on the exact same load profile in the exact same environment, and your profiler should suddenly show the problem has vanished, right? The profiler was showing this method is taking like 29 milliseconds every time. The next time the profiler shows like this method is taking like 1 millisecond. Now that's good. But that has to be on a repeatable and automated setup so that you can't make human errors. You can't just go from like 50 agents on Go to like one agent on Go and then say that, oh, now my build is shutting fast enough. That's not good.
Yeah. So, like you said, don't go overboard in fixing performance issues. Like, contrary to what, don't give any hype to it. It's like any other problem on your system. Like, the reason we wanted to start our talk with this was because there used to be a time in our product where any performance issues would give jitters to our product manager, would give sleepless nights to our development team. Everybody would be scared because, like, they're scared because of the unknown involved in it, right? But the problem is, it's like any other thing. Like, it's software at the end of the day, right? All we did, like, it's an expertise that we didn't have. And it's an expertise that is not very well documented, but then it's easy to gain. I mean, it just needs some, our whole approach now is, we don't, like, if it's a performance issue, we treat it like any other bug. We say, okay, fine, dude, it's fine. Like, what's, like, it's a bug.
It's another part of the bug tracker.
It's a part of the bug tracker. We treat it the way we treat any other piece of work, right? So that's the thing that we wanted to start off with. Don't go overboard trying to, like, oh my god, we have a performance problem. You know, don't go overboard. You can easily define acceptance criteria for it. The moment you can figure out what is the work involved and what does it mean for me, and if I have automated scripts for it, it doesn't need to get the importance or the risk factor that typically it is given. Like, it's that's the thing that we wanted to talk about.
So, a typical cycle that we figured out after a lot of fixing and finding issues is this. It's essentially a fish. So, you start at this point. You measure what you have. With this measurement, somewhere here, you realize that you have a performance issue. Then you fix the performance issue. You again come back and measure. And you realize, oops, my fix hasn't worked. And then you fix it. And you come back and measure. And you iterate on it as many times as you need to. Eventually, because what we just said was find your end goal, right? Decide what your end goal is. Once the end goal is reached, you abort out of this. And you come back and stop. So what is the problem with it? With me starting at fix. The problem starting here is that I have not yet found the problem, right?
Like, you get a call from a customer saying, oh, my page is slow, right? What you do, you open up your code, you look at the code parts, you say, oh, I found a problem, you fix it. That should not be how you follow it at all, right?
So user saying it's slow, all right, that is a performance problem, but I haven't yet figured out what exactly is slow. Is it taking out of 1 second that the page is taking to load, is it taking 50 seconds, it taking like 50 milliseconds, or it taking like 500 milliseconds, or it taking like 750 milliseconds? That's important, right? I want to attack the 750 milliseconds first.
And you have no idea how many times where we didn't have to do anything here because of a wrong memory configuration of the app. You know, like, you have no, like, that's why it's very important for you to measure, because if you measure, it may be working fine for you, which means that then you say, hey, user, do you have, like, enough heap associated with it? Is your process swapping? You know, like, there are so many things that you could easily find out that you don't even need to get into this place, because this is expensive. It's developer's time, right? Let's say you're billing at $40 an hour. That's how much money you will spend in order to do this. But if you have had an automated setup already, that would be free. It doesn't require any of your time.
And your automated setup will allow you to do this as many times as you want, and you just decide that you want to start a shop. That's it.
Like, this is the most expensive part of the process, so don't do this. Avoid doing this, right? So that's the message.
What if I stop at fix? Like I said, if I stop at fix, I haven't yet measured and informed myself that the fix actually works. And I stop at fix, I deploy it to the customers, and the customer says, oops, it's still slow. Guess what, I fixed nothing. So, you have to go to fix, and you have to come back to measure, you have to ensure that measurement shows you very, very clearly that the problem is gone, and then you ship it to the customer. So, yeah, that's... why do I need to iterate? Because one fix that is tried may not work, you may have to try another fix, and a third fix, and a fourth fix. And also, one fix might affect it by a certain percentage, but that's not good enough. According to your benchmarks, you've decided that your page has to load in under 500 milliseconds, and if it's 550 milliseconds, just not good enough. And then you gotta add another 50 milliseconds here, and then reiterate and figure out, oops, now it loads in 490 milliseconds on.
And in our experience, theory of constraints plays massive role here. Like, if you are familiar with theory of constraints, most of the times only the first constraint shows up in measurement. If you remove that, guess what? There are like lots of other constraints that have not even been uncovered in your measurement. So the first fix only removed this constraint, but then there are so many other constraints for you to remove by the time you hit your acceptance criteria, right? So that's why we have to, it's very important for you to iterate. The, just by fixing the problem that you uncovered does not make your app fast,
and
typically.
And sometimes it's so important that you might have fixed something, and actually fixed something, like that is a real fix. It's not fake one that is done without measurement. And you may come back and realize, by fixing that, I made something else worse, right? Because that's the nature of contention issues. Lock contention, if you fix one, it moves to another place. If that another place is more contended for than the original place, then you made it worse, right? And guess what? That other place may be contended for by a more important part of the app than the web page itself or than the backend itself, right? And then you have made not only this thing worse, you have also made the other piece that was using this contended portion worse. So it's very important to go into this cycle. How long should I iterate? Obviously, your benchmarks will tell you. When you have achieved your benchmarks and when you have not made anything else worse, over here you will realize that your benchmarks have been met and you just get out of the cycle, right? So intuition, unlike functional bugs, where intuition works marvelously, intuition works like really, really bad when you're working with performance issues. So please do not go by your intuition. Even though your intuition tells you that it's a GC issue, please take a profile and figure out this lock and mention if you're not a GC issue. And when you're absolutely doubly sure, only then go and apply a fix. Always go by proof, be mathematical. So,
yeah, in terms of measurements, the easy and obvious one is page response time. You have no idea how many times we get asked about, oh, do you guys use JMeter? Do you guys use Apache Benchmark? Do you guys use HTTP? And most people, when they are thinking of performance testing, they are really thinking of load testing and they are really thinking of loading only the user pages. I mean, that is the very, like, that's like the dream, that's the easy part. So for us, the more easy and obvious ones is that. The not so easy one is, how do you define app throughput? How do you measure your app throughput? How do you measure your message queue performance? How do you measure your CPU IO churn? How do you measure your database performance? Lock contentions. If I have like really long, like one thread holds a lock for a long time, there are like 100 other threads which are waiting for a lock. And if it's in a managed environment, how do I even get that information? Because everything on your machine is fine, your IO is fine, your CPU is fine, your heap usage is fine, but my app is like shit slow, right? So probably it's a lock contention issue. How do you even measure that? Right? How do you measure environment specific things like memory usage and GC churn? How do you even figure out environmental issues? My hard disk, for some reason, my hard disk is slow. Like Ram was our ops person for a long time. He knows of a few instances where our own production server had like a problematic IO drive, and we spent a lot of time trying to figure out why the hell is my DB taking so slow. Like, are my queries like really non-performant? But it turned out that our performance had dropped about 16 times because of a bad disk. You know, like, how do you even measure such things? Those are the things that we think are more important when it comes to performance testing. Like, using JMeter and AB is easy. Using these things and understanding and interpreting the output, and trust me, this is a lot of data. Like, JJ actually plotted a 24-dimension cube in order to plot all this data, and we just, like, you know, we're, okay, fine, it's a good intellectual thought experiment, we'll keep it aside, because there is no correlation that can be established. So that's something that we quickly realized, right? So you need to have people look at this output and figure out, okay, what the hell is going on, right? So that's why we think that what to measure is a super important thing, and don't just go with JMeter, and don't just go with AB, you know, like, think of all the things that you need to do, and remember, understand your environment. Like we said, we know how to do these things on Linux, but we have no idea how to do these things on, let's say, Solaris, or on Windows, or on Mac. You know, like, we don't know. Probably for you, like, you know, if you have deployment from those environments, you need to understand it really well.
For instance, something for us to, we are very DB heavy. Our DB is always under severe load. If I don't understand that my DB is under severe load and it's doing a lot of IO, and if I don't understand that my server is running on SSD and it is indeed running on SSD, say, in that case, if I use anticipatory IO scheduler on Linux kernel, I'm sorted, right? Anticipatory IO scheduler is just not made for that, it's made for magnetic disks. You are using the wrong tool in the wrong place. It's like round pegs in square holes. It just doesn't make any sense. So yeah, like, those kind of things is what we mean by understanding.
And like, the reason you need all this is because we are talking about scale up. Because it's very easy for you to scale out, but for us, the really interesting engineering problem is scaling up. So that's what we are trying to address here. Because most of the times your CPU is really powerful. You have really fast RAM and you have really fast I/O, right? And your network is fast. We are saying, okay, fine, we'll not leverage any of that, we'll just scale out. You know, but for us that's like a pop-out. Like what we are trying to do here is let us understand the computer science behind it, let us scale up, right? So that's what this is all about. So the tools we used was, yes, for user load we used something called Apache Benchmark. It's a very nice tool. We used HTPerf, that's also good. AB and HTPerf are native. JMeter is actually on Java. So we actually found that JMeter itself has performance issues because of which you can't really load up to what you want. So for us, AB and HTPerf is a much nicer option than JMeter. So the app throughput, we typically, for us, like, we have tools which let us do Java level counts. So Java has this thing called JSTAT and JMAP and things like that. So you can do heap scan. So there are Java JVM tools and there are equivalent tools for your VM. So you should probably start exploring those tools where it gives you these kind of counts. Then you have, we use something called ActiveMQ for our queuing. ActiveMQ exposes really nice statistics over our management console. So we use that for measuring this.
It might be RabbitMQ, it might be any other queuing system that you use.
So most queuing systems do have this in the mind when they are built. So any serious queuing system will expose this data. Then in order to measure CPU IO churn, the most obvious one is the load average. Then we have IOSTAT, we use iNotify. For DB performance, we use a profiler called YourKit. If you are working on a JVM, YourKit, YourKit, it's like, don't bother looking at any other thing. It's not that expensive, it is comprehensive. Like, it's one of the best JVM profiling tools out there. Like, I don't know where we would be without YourKit. Like, YourKit is like, when you perform an open heart surgery, like all the tools that a surgeon would need, those are the things that YourKit provides. So,
and YourKit is available for Java and for .NET, so people who are working on .NET environment, it's there for you as well.
So. Yeah, so and YourKit basically figures out every single thing that can ever be measured on JVM and it gives you that. So it's your single stop thing.
Anything similar for Ruby?
For Ruby, there are tools that are available to measure the requests. They're like Rails plugins used by Rabbit and networks. But there's no equivalent of YourKit which can we can generate like a snapshot that you can look at for sure. So.
For log contention again YourKit.
So log contention, right? If you're dealing with other environments like non-Java and non-.NET environments, you can probably if you don't find anything that monitors log contention, you can write your own extensions. Locks are normally implemented either as spin locks or semaphores, and you can just wrap an if around that, and if an environment will set, you can lock. And you can just grep and hawk on that lock to figure out the kind of data that you want to figure out. So.
Yeah, so again, manage environment specific GC locks, JVM provides GC locks, so you can just look at GC locks or equivalent of that in any other thing. environment specific things, so we use like netstat, ps, dmessage. Like, yeah, I mean, dmessage, right? So, basically anything that will tell us if the machine itself is slow. So,
this file is incredibly useful when you're trying to reason anything in the user space. It's like the most compact source of information from the kernel side for you. So, yeah, this file is amazing. Go back and look at it. It is obviously on Linux kernel, so remember that. But other kernels might have equivalent of this.
Yeah, I mean, going back to what JJ said, round pegs for round holes. So figure out what is the right tool for you and use only those tools. And in order to figure out what tools to use, you need to understand what needs to be measured. In order to understand what needs to be, you know, like that's the chain of reasoning. So tools comes at the end. The understanding comes first. So try to understand your environment, your problems, and then figure out what tools to use.
With least possible overhead here, like I just explained, right? If you don't have a log contention profiler, you want to write like a simple enhancement to your runtime. You have to compile it again and start using that. But remember, if you start flushing to disk your log messages for your log condition profiling every single time, then you're probably going to be locked on I/O all time, and you're not going to get like right kind of data from that log condition profiler, right? So ensure that you buffer it very well, ensure you expand your buffer size appropriately. A professional profiler like YorkIt is like really, really good at doing that.
YorkIt is open source?
No, YorkIt is not open source. Yeah, that's a sad thing about YorkIt, it's not open source. But if you write it, just be sure that your buffers are like correctly configured to the right size, it flushes at the right time, there's a dedicated thread that does not get logged when it's trying to flush. So like get all the mathematics right. So at this point we're gonna start talking about little bit of fixes. So what did we fix eventually after going through all that exercise? We are gonna get into the nature of fixes in some time. So it's important to understand your libraries, read the fine print and documentation. If you can afford to read code, if you have time for that, please read code. It's often that the performance problems that you see is not caused by your app, it's caused by a library, and fixing that issue is really as simple as just taking this library and swapping it with another one, or just taking this library, patching it and applying the patch to your production code base. So yeah, like don't miss out on that one. Don't assume that all libraries are like perfect. Be mechanical. Start with measuring, go to fix, come back to measuring, go to fix, come back to measuring, and then stop. So don't try to skip steps because you've done it like 10 times. Oh, now I kind of know it. You're bound to go wrong.
Which is where we say intuition works badly. So intuition, the last 10 times you have worked on it, the 11th time you will go wrong. You know, like it's.
If you have a connection, definitely maybe you are different, but yeah, like for the rest of us humans, intuition works very, very poorly. So you should use it. You should be okay with using it. Exaggerated load to magnify the problem. If you're trying to just get a load profile of one page and that particular page is slow, it's okay to load that page really heavily so that you see, after you fix, right, you see a difference from 5 seconds to 1 second versus 5 milliseconds to 1 millisecond, right? So that magnification sometimes very clearly tells you that you are doing the right thing. So feel free to use the exaggerated load and then like higher concurrency, higher number of requests to get the right data out. You can use the same, you have to use the same load profile to test your fix that you use to reproduce the problem, right? So that in the same situation, your code is behaving better now compared to before. You have to be rigorous, add up the numbers. If you have like 5 calls in a method and each call takes X, Y, and Z amount of time, you have to add that X, Y, and Z and then decide the method's time over that X, Y, and Z and figure out what the delta is. Is this method taking all the time or are all the call methods taking all the time? Be rigorous in all this reasoning, don't just be superficial. So that's important. You should encourage mock pairing on complicated fixes when I have to reason a really bad log. I would rather call him and not do it alone. And he would rather call me or someone else in the team. And that way you are likely to see all the corner cases. You're trying to fix logs, right? So you don't introduce a race condition, you don't introduce some kind of data corruption, you're not foregoing a log statement that helps you reason out in case of bugs.
Typically
so
in logs, it's safer to be more granular than less granular. Whenever we reduce the granularity of logs, we are generally, you know, like it's generally a risky operation in the sense that, and the risk is data corruption.
It's more performant, but it's risky.
It's risky, right? So that's what we attack.
Whenever you're trying to fix problems, don't attack 3 problems and then think, okay, alright, I'll fix these 3 problems and then I'll profile again and I'll measure and I'll verify that everything is fixed. No, don't do that. Attack 1 problem at a time so that you know exactly what is the impact of the fix on other areas, right? If I'm fixing my page load time, my scheduling shouldn't go for it off. Because then I've made a more important area worse and that's not good.
Yeah,
so,
I mean, I know that most developers are like really good. But it's okay. Like we know we can take on 4 problems at the same time in the same batch, fix all of them. But it's okay. Don't do it. It's fine. The overhead of not doing it is not much. So
having said all that, correctness always comes first. A performant but incorrect app is no good.
Like you don't want a banking application which is wrong. It's okay to have a slow banking application.
So this is the gist of what we just covered. So so now we are getting nature of fixes.
So let's say somebody told us what the problem is. We understand how to go about doing it. Now what are typically the nature of the problems that you fix in terms of log contentions? By synchronization we talk about log contention, right? So typically what happens is if you look at one class calls another class calls another class calls a DB, right? So typically you have a lock here, you have a lock here, you have a lock here, you have a lock here. So let's say you made this granular. That doesn't matter if this is very it's very wide. If you fix this, this could still be white. If you fix it, everybody accesses the database, so database lock might. You know, so typically when you fix one lock, it has the nature of granularity of locks is such that once you fix one place, it keeps moving on. So it's very important for you to keep that thing in mind and fix it. More than one shared, if you have two data structures which get accessed across different methods, it requires synchronization. You just cannot do lockless concurrency there. I mean, it's just theoretically impossible, right? So don't even bother trying. If you have more than one shared memory things that get accessed, it's just you have to synchronize. There's no way you can not synchronize it.
It's mathematically proved, so yeah.
Yeah, like
I don't even worry about locklessness. Yeah, transactional memory is a replacement for lock at the cost of retrying. Yeah.
Right. So I mean, sure you can, but even transactional memory, if you have two different transactional things, right?
You have to put them in one transaction, otherwise
you can't have two different transactions, right? So that's the equivalent of this. So you have to put them in a single transaction. there are something called globally unique objects. It's called interned objects. So interned objects are pretty useful. You'll see how we leverage interned objects.
Java has a notion of permgen pool. It's called permanent generation pool. So permgen pool usually keeps things like classes. It keeps things like unique copy of a string. A string foo is equal to a string foo anywhere else in the system, but it might not be the same reference, right? Interning means that it is the same reference essentially. The concept comes from common Lisp, but it's used widely in Java. Atomic operations, you obviously know what it is. It's XCMP, XCG. So, compare and swap. So, that is an atomic operation, for instance.
Remember that typical lock fixes jumps places, unlike functional bugs. Functional bugs are typically, I did not take care of a corner case, I fix it, it's localized in one place. Lock contentions are typically, they move all over the place. So, you need to like, measure them properly.
So look beyond local impact of the fix. You haven't made anything worse, that's the punchline. Okay, so nature of fixes with respect to GC. GC is garbage collection. When you hear from a user that unresponsiveness is intermittent, as in once in like 20 seconds, I see it being very slow, but otherwise it's very fast. It might be a GC issue. It is likely not easy to fix because it may begin either in your code base if you're lucky or in somebody else's code base, and it's a library that you're using if you're unlucky. If you're really, really unlucky, then the library might be like proprietary and you're not even allowed. You're not even allowed to see its code. So yeah, like be really careful there. But the root cause, maybe you are a library, like I said, one of the really nice tools for GC is Java's GC logs. I'm sure other VMs expose GC logs as well. If they don't, it's really simple. You have to go to the garbage collector and start logging there. It's as simple as that. Again, take care of buffering if you're doing it yourself. Profile to see if majority of allocations are just from a handful of calls. That means if there's a method called foo, bar, and bars, and these are the three most important methods in my app, very frequently called. If foo is generating most of the garbage, I'm happy. If there are like 200 such calls and each of them is generating 1% of the garbage or 0.5% of the garbage, then it's very hard to fix that. And each is contributing like very little fragment to the whole chunk of garbage you're generating. It's extremely hard to fix. Then try to play with the GCR bond mix and try to figure out what is the right kind of
don't even bother fixing that. If you have like garbage spread all over the place, each contributing like a few MBs, it's like a super hard problem to fix.
Unless you have like one full year to only fix that, you'll probably not get it right.
Yeah, so you would rather fix GC algorithms of your VM than like use the right algorithm for you. Right?
So throughput collector is probably not the right thing for you. You want to use a concurrent collector.
Things like that.
So tweak your max min omitted allocation. So normally VM says, alright, because I'm a VM, I can let you dictate how much memory do you want to ever dedicate to your VM. If it goes beyond that, you want me to bomb and tell you I'm out of memory. So you configure the max min limits like that. Don't configure them far apart, because if you configure them far apart, it might start crashing. It's amortized cost of one, but when it crashes, your request will be intermittently slow. So malloc and free are system calls. They're expensive, so try to not use them often. We are going to skip over DB. DB has got nothing to do with managed environments. It's nice insights, but you can read it up online. We'll come back to thrashing. So thrashing is about your number of processes and your number of real cores. So if you have like too few cores and you have too many processes, what's going to happen? Context switch is going to happen. Every time context switch happens, your CPU caches get wiped cold. Your TLB goes for a toss. If you're not on x86, your TLB cannot be populated without, what is it called? A page fault, right? And page faults are expensive and blah, blah, blah. So you don't want that ratio to be extremely odd. A little bit of odd ratio is fine because you are normally blocked on IO and not on CPU, so that makes the world happy. If you have too many locks, that will cause too many sleeps. Locks are normally implemented as semaphores, which means the locking thread goes to sleep, the semaphore keeps, so semaphore registers the locking thread on a listener list of the locker, and when locker comes out, it says, oops, the first, looks like the thread's waiting for me, so I'll just wake up the first thread and I'll let go. And when the first thread gets a lock, the rest of them keep sleeping. So sleep-based locks cause context switching, very important. So like I said, context switching gets your CPU caches L1, L2, L3 and gets the TLB. So yeah, being extremely careful. Too frequent IO, obviously IO includes waits, right? Reads are blocking. When you try to read something, it will wait. Your call just cannot return unlike writes. So it'll go to the disk, it'll come back from there, it'll return your data. If you're lucky, it'll be cached, but most of us are, like I said, no connection with definitely rate. So use of swap can completely kill it. It will not only be a page fault, it will also be a page load from the bloody disk, and the disk is extremely, extremely slow. It's like order of magnitude slower, so you never trust your disk. Overlogging can be hurtful. Neither your OS nor your in-VM cache will be able to save you if you are overlogging. Like you're logging a stack trace every 1 millisecond. Oh boy, you're so dead. Right. So, concept of buffered IO exists for a reason, as in, even if you're hitting it from the disk, you may as well load a huge chunk in one shot than loading like one line at one shot and keep loading it. That leads to performance issues, so keep a buffer over there. You can use memory mapped IO. If you're using memory mapped IO, please don't close your file descriptor, because then memory mapping also goes away, then it comes back, and then it goes away, and then there's no point. So, assigning very low max memory limit can cause frequent GCs. The way GCs work in a native thread system like Java is all threads wait. I'll go and garbage collect. I'll free up some memory. I'll remove the fragmentation, and then I'll say all threads start, right? And when all threads wait, obviously your user thread is waiting, your email thread is waiting, all your threads are waiting, right? So that's bad.
Yeah. So basically, thrashing is basically about all your apart from your app, what are the other things that can go wrong in your environment, right? Common pitfalls for us, when this is pitfalls that we have faced, there may be other pitfalls that you might have or will face. So the first important problem we had was prejudice. because this prejudice comes from intuition, right? we had this bad notion called SSL is bad. But once we made it go through our measurement exercise, it actually turned out that a lot of our performance problems was not because of SSL. In fact, it was not even close to what DB was causing us in terms of problems. So using asynchronicity to avoid fixing root cause. So I have a lock, right? What do I do? A user clicks on something, it takes forever to come because it's locked on the backend. So what do? I return the user thread really fast. The request thread returns with, oh, I accepted your request. That makes the click really fast. But the actual throughput of the system is still slow. So just by introducing a message bus there does not make your app fast. In fact, it makes your app slow because it's asynchronous. The real work that will now happen at its own sweet time. Which means that instead of synchronously finishing it in 5 seconds, it might now take 15 seconds or 20 seconds. So you need to be really, you need to understand exactly what it means when you're introducing a message
there. In case of Java, it even means object serialization. I mean, beat that. The entire object graph gets serialized, sent across to the other thread. The thread says, okay, now I'm ready to read it. It reads the entire object graph, and then it starts processing it. So many extra CPU cycles wasted there. I mean, that's like really, really bad.
Yeah, so don't, so for us, the prejudice was, oh, use a message queue there, you'll be fast. No.
And we had made that mistake, we got burned, so yeah.
So that comes from prejudice. Lack of testing. We had a myth called we can't have more than 150 workers. But that myth got carried over for, like, we are a 5-year-old app. that myth existed for the first 3 years. And about 2 years ago, we said, okay, fine. What is this myth? Let's just go and test it. And then it, we could easily go up to 1,000 agents and 1,000 worker slaves, and nothing happened. And we were like, oh, wait a minute. What's that, right? So it's all about, like, in any project, you have myths, you have prejudices. It's very important for you to keep all of those aside. Be mechanical, be rigorous. So that's why lack of setup understanding. We have a misconception that 64-bit JVM is slow. But guess what? For all our, like, we asked Ram to move his current setup to a 64-bit JVM. Because we just realized that, oh, that has got nothing to do with slowness all the time. Like, it does have some overhead when you have smaller heap sizes. But for larger heap sizes, it's fine. It doesn't really make you that slow.
And x86-64 is so much faster that you will not believe it. Its MMU can address what? 16 times more references with one page than 32-bit. It has a dedicated syscall instruction. You don't do INT 0x80 anymore. So there's a lot of these things. Your registers are bigger. There are a lot of these things that you can leverage.
64-bit
JVM
can also use SSE.
Right. SSE2 is obviously faster than
that. Right. And typically, 32-bit JVM or 64-bit JVM has to go through an emulation, right? Which means that emulation adds overhead.
Yeah. So there's this native emulation layer that allows you to address
it. Right. Which means that basically, this was clearly a lack of understanding. So, so these are common pitfalls that you will run into a long running project. So we spoke about this already. There are uncharted waters in all projects, so you need to be careful about them.
You can read this up online. If you want, we are running short of time, so yeah,
okay.
Let's get to the interesting bits.
So know what you're getting into. Like most of the times when you jump into the deep end of the river, it's not only the problem is not just it's deep, it might have crocodiles in them. Like these crocodiles are unknowns and you basically don't know what you're getting into. So make sure that you know that there are crocodiles waiting there for you. And these crocodiles are what makes everybody scared of performance issues. But if you know how to get around them and how to not get killed by these crocodiles, it's
instead of being here, you have to be here.
Right, exactly.
That's the So again, you can read up.
So war stories, typically, like, this is a 2-hour presentation that we do. These war stories are all the things that we experience in our project and how we fix them. We can't share our code in a public forum. So what we have done is we have gotten the same kind of problems in a sample code, and we will show you how it was before and how you can probably fix it. So the what we are doing here is basically we want to fetch an XML document from a remote service. The fetcher, the client, has some configurations which are persisted in a database. The configuration's name is passed inside, is passed. So you say, okay, use this client, give me the data, use this client, let the client fetch the XML document from a remote service and give me that. So that's what this method does. So you go to the repo, use the name and find that client, and
if you don't have it,
you create a client and you put it back into the repository you persist it. Then what you're doing here is you want to eagerly fetch all the documents that are available in the remote service and cache it locally so that you don't want to keep making remote service calls.
Let's say it exposes get page count number of documents and you're trying to make RPC calls to each one of them
and you're putting them into a cache. So you took all the elements that the remote service gave you, you want to cache it, you want to just log it and you return it. Okay?
And please notice that it has service level or whatever, the object level synchronization over there.
But then somebody who wrote this code knew that it needs to be synchronized because you are caching it. So the cache data structure is being accessed. If multiple people access the same cache data structure at the same time, you need to synchronize it, right? So it's obvious. So fine.
And the other things also, like you're creating a new client, you want to implement the ID of that. And you want, somebody outside wants to know how many clients your system has, so you have this little getter method over here that also synchronized and
okay.
Right?
So this is the implementation. Somebody has done this, deployed it, beautifully works on their local box. They even took care of caching. They deployed it. In production, this particular method call got 1,000 concurrent requests at the same time. What do you think happens?
yes, lot of caching happened. So right. The answer was lot of caching happened, and yes, that is true.
That is true.
It is over caching.
Right. What else?
Right. Correct. So this and that locks in the same object, same time, not good.
Mm-hmm. Okay, there are subtler problems here. If you see, we are doing a log.debug here, right? And this string gets evaluated.
Anyone has any idea how big this thing is? An array list of all the DOM that you have loaded, which means it's going to spew out pages and pages of HTML or XML.
Probably, right? And it's log.debug. Most people don't run their production apps with a logger level set at debug, which means that you are computing this string and logger is ignoring it, right? and in Java, because strings are immutable, one string, two strings, three strings, multiple strings here, which means that every time, in my example of 1000 concurrent requests, for each of the so there are about 4000 strings that got constructed, which got completely ignored. So this is garbage. The moment this stack frame goes out of stack frame pops, the reference to this is gone. So it garbage collects.
And guess what? In production, you are logging info. You are not even using that string.
Right. Exactly.
So how dumb can that
be? It's insane amount of garbage being generated for no apparent reason. Right. So that's a subtler bug. Then synchronization is here, which means that this access and this access is blocked. And then there's one more subtle bug. You are caching an array list, right? Most caches, if you have configured a cache has this notion called number of objects in memory. In this case, there's only one object in memory.
And that object has this many items inside it, and each one of them is huge.
So if there were 1000 accessors to different clients, let's say there were 20 clients, cache tells you, yes, there are 20 objects, but the cache size is 3 GB. Right?
That's really nasty.
And you look at and probably cache explorer's management bean, you say, okay, oh my god, my heap has gone massively high, and cache obviously has a hard reference because you don't want it to GC. So you have a 3 GB hard reference data. You look at cache, you have only 20 objects. What the hell is happening, right?
So you immediately discount cache, right? You say, okay, cache is not causing it, cache is only 20 objects, supposed to have 100, right?
So that is where these are not very obvious problems, but these are all like really massive problems in a highly concurrent app with the high throughput requirements.
So now we are going, so we had a fixed thing in the middle which would show you how it looks with fixed.
Yeah,
I'll very quickly show it to you. It's very ugly. So we're going to refactored fixes. So to quickly cover, because we're running out of time, we have wrapped this with islog debug, so we're not causing unnecessary GC churn. The synchronization keyword has gone from there, it has gone over here. Instead of caching all the elements and caching an array list, I'm caching each element separately. So my cache actually reflects how many objects it has, how many real objects, right? And I don't have transactional anymore, so I'm not trying to cache in transactions, because if transaction gets rolled back, my cache is
happy. If you guys want just a quick dump on what happens if you cache inside a transaction, please talk to us offline. It's a crazy, crazy problem. You don't want to cache inside transactions.
Even if you have transactional caches, it is a crazy problem.
Yeah, so in a concurrent app, so we can talk about it offline. It's a really insane issue.
The call get client here, so you can.
Okay.
We'll take just half a moment. The key over here is for the element. So this entry is being cached with this key synchronization, and the get client.
So
call,
this is called a double check lock. So
this is called a double check lock. Extremely useful construct in synchronization.
Yeah, so what we are trying to do here is basically we want to show you all the things that could go wrong, and we have fixed a lot of them.
And this is only 20% of the actual slide deck. So you should go back and read the slide to try to make sense of it.
Yeah.
Here again double check locking here, this one and this one. And again, same kind of construct. Try to get it from the cache. If you can't find it, take a lock. Try to get it from the cache. If you can't find it, do an actual call. Get it. If it's still null, then create it. The create method itself is transaction, but the whole method is not. So I can legally put things into my cache without going wrong, right? And the synchronization keyword has gone away. It is only over here.
So we basically reduce the granularity of the cache. We reduce the GC churn. We are right. We are caching the right things in our cache. Cache will tell us now the right number of objects in the cache. And then there is something.
And how did we create the synchronization? That's really important. This is an interned string being interned over here. So it's a globally unique reference across the entire JVM. So I can legally lock on that. The create client method is transactional, but it does very little, so that's nice. I'm not accessing any cache over there. the synchronization here is also gone away. If you look at it, it's an atomic operation that I'm using. Increment and get internally uses compare and swap. It'll increment it by one, try to do a compare and swap. If it fails, it'll increment it by one, try to again and again and again. It's a loop, right? So this is called a spin lock. In the kernel terms, this is called a spin lock. This prevents process preemption in the kernel space, but over here, it's not using semaphore, so it's not making you flip to non-schedulable, then flip to schedulable while doing a cache screen. So this is a really nice constant. Go back and look at all the atomic operations that UVM supports. So with that, we'll...
So go back to the mock stories if you are interested. This is probably about 20% of all the things that we have covered in that.
Questions will be offline if you're interested. We'll come back and talk to us.
Thanks, guys.